Super Mario Bros. 3 is a game that can be beaten incredibly fast. This video will be covering a TAS I created that completes the game in 0.215948. Wait, hold on. I can turn this into a fraction. 386,000. Less than a quarter of a second. And in order to beat a video game in less than a quarter of a second, you can imagine there's a lot to explain. Let's not waste any time. A tool-assisted speedrun is nothing more than a sequence of button presses on a timeline. It's like a MIDI playback, but for a video game instead of music. For instance, suppose we have this sequence of inputs: Mario falls in the hole and dies. By using emulator tools, we can go back and fix this mistake. We can also use other emulator tools, or even write our own tools. In theory, if we take enough time to put in enough effort to optimize things using the currently known strategies, we can create the perfect run of a video game. Or maybe, instead of going for the fastest time, we just want to hunt for new exploits, or even showcase a glitch that's inhumanly difficult. A tool-assisted superplay is the type of task where a goal can be whatever you want it to be. For instance, I have a video explaining how the Bad Apple music video, along with footage of Doom, can be played inside Super Mario Bros. Using nothing more than a sequence of button presses. But for this video, let's talk more about the speedrun than the superplay. I also believe the context behind this quarter-second run is important, so how did we get here? On the TASVideos forum page for Mario 3, a user named RAT926 made an interesting discovery. They were exploring around entering pipes in unusual ways in 7-1. Shared via a .fm2 file, a TAS file for the FCEU emulator, RAT926 entered this pipe in the wrong direction. After exiting the pipe, they jumped, which led to the cutscene returning the wand to the king! Though Mario was currently stuck in a corner of the World 8 map, this just skipped all of World 7. Whoa! Here in the future, we have a privileged perspective, as we know this trick has other uses. Within 3 days, it was discovered that this can be used to warp directly to the game's ending cutscene. An unoptimized proof of concept TAS was put together 2 days later, and by the end of the month, an optimized TAS was published, completing the game in 2 minutes, 54.98 seconds. Now, to fully understand how this wrong warp works, you kinda need to know the basics of 6502 assembly programming. And in order to know how the even faster TAS works, it doesn't hurt to know how this one works. Unfortunately, this video is not a full guide to 6502 assembly, but I will attempt to explain everything in such a way that assembly knowledge is not fully required. Here's what's important. Assembly code is assembled into machine code. It's just a series of bytes. These bytes are processed one at a time. The program counter, or PC, determines which byte to process next. It's like how a karaoke machine shows you what part of the lyrics to sing, except instead of words, it's bytes for the NES to process. Typically, the program counter is pointing to ROM, somewhere between address hex 8000 and hex FFFF. But RAM, which is from address 0 to address 7FF, is also just a series of bytes. They could be interpreted as instructions. In fact, there are several games that will intentionally store a function inside RAM. Anyway, the point is, it can happen, and bytes and RAM can be executed as assembly code, whether intentional or not. If you are able to manipulate those bytes and RAM, and then execute them, we call that arbitrary code execution. Mario 3 has code at address 8FE3 that, when executed, prepares the victory screen of the game. If we want to move the PC to 8FE3, in order to execute that code, winning the game, we need to execute a jump or JSR instruction to move the program counter to address 8FE3, executing it, and winning the game. Basically, hitting this note block starts a chain of events that will eventually underflow the stack and move the program counter to address 81 in RAM. The exposition of enemies is at address hex 91, so as long as those 16 bytes between address hex 81 and hex 91 don't crash the game or move the PC, we can write assembly code using the exposition of enemies. JSR 8FE3 is written as 20 E3 8F, which when executed, wins the game. And that's how this task by Lord Tom and Tompa beats the game in 2 minutes, 54.98 seconds. Anyway, now that I've explained the fundamentals of arbitrary code execution, let's talk about the actual purpose of this video, the task that beats the game in less than a quarter of a second. Suppose we're trying to find a new way to execute arbitrary code faster. We need a new method to move the PC to RAM faster. AIS523 devised a new method, and then Total used it to beat Super Mario Bros. 3 in 0.216 seconds. This was showcased at SGDQ 2016 with an artificial 2-second delay so the audience could see the game before the credits. But uh-oh, the game softlocks in the credits! In 2019, MasterJune created a version of this TAS that doesn't softlock the game. I would like to emphasize the absolute genius behind the 2019 submission by MasterJune and AIS523. Along with the efforts of Alyosha, who created the sub-Neshawk core of BizHawk, this run paved the way for Subframe speedruns. I would also like to emphasize that their TAS has several more steps than mine, and it's easier to just explain my TAS. So, what's this new method for moving the PC to RAM? If you've ever seen this TAS, you might have heard of it. It's the DPCM audio bug workaround exploit, and I promise I will explain what all of that means. The audio chip can play audio samples with two methods, PCM, pulse code modulation, and DPCM, differential pulse code modulation. PCM audio is done by repeated writes to address 4011. See the Bad Apple TAS explanation for an example. DPCM audio samples are played by writing to various audio chip registers a single time each, and the entire audio sample is played one byte at a time automatically by the audio chip. Whenever the audio chip needs another byte, it runs something called a DMA, or direct memory access. However, this DMA, which is the way the audio chip reads from ROM in order to prepare for the next 8 bits of the audio sample being played, has a negative side effect. You see, typically the way the DMC DMA works is by halting the CPU for about 4 CPU cycles. Sometimes it's only halted for 3, don't worry about that. From this table, you can see that the DMA will read the next sample and put it in the shift register. After that happens, the halted CPU resumes execution. However, here's the side effect. Simplified. If this DMA happens during an instruction that reads from a controller port, this also clocks the controller. Gasp! What does clocking the controller mean? Basically, here's the way controller reading is supposed to work. First, the controller is strobed, which records the buttons currently pressed into a shift register inside the controller. To fully read a controller, the controller is clocked 8 times, each time sending a single bit to the CPU. There are 8 buttons on the controller, so the controller needs to be read 8 times. If the DMA happens on the wrong CPU cycle of this process, an extra bit is shifted, effectively corrupting the data from the controller. Brief recap, if the NES is playing DPCM audio samples and the next byte of the sample is fetched while the CPU is reading from the controller ports, the controller data is corrupted. This is called the DPCM audio bug. This is a hardware bug of the Nintendo Entertainment System, so it would affect every game that uses DPCM audio samples. The developers of Mario 3 were aware of this issue. The music uses DPCM audio samples for the drums. So the programmers needed to solve a problem. How do they prevent data from the controller from getting corrupt? They need some sort of DPCM audio bug workaround. Suppose it's the 80s. You are a programmer working at Nintendo on a game that uses DPCM audio for the music. Let's say about 1% of the times you read all 8 buttons from a controller, the data read by the CPU was incorrect. You are tasked with programming a solution. There are several ways to work around this issue. For instance, if you are incredibly savvy, you might know that the issue is due to the audio chip's DMA. As the programmer, when playing DPCM samples, you also set the sample rate. This means you know the exact number of CPU cycles that occur between each DMA. The fastest sample rate will take 432 CPU cycles between each DMA, and reading all 8 bits of the controller will take about 200 cycles. Here's where you, the programmer, start thinking outside the box. Why should you only read the controller once per frame? If you read the controller multiple times, you get a sample size greater than 1. If you read the controller twice in a row and the values read match, you know mathematically that the DMA did not corrupt the controller. This is because the 432 cycle rate of the DMA is longer than the time spent reading the controller twice. If you read the controllers twice in a row and they don't match, it's impossible to tell which value was the corrupted one. Discard the first value read and run the controller reading code again. Still no match? Discard the older value and read again. This is the DPCM audio bug workaround. And yes, this does prevent the DPCM audio bug. However, in a world where we can place different inputs at any moment on a timeline, and I mean any moment, we could exploit this. What if when the controllers are being read, we maliciously decide to change the buttons we're pressing every time the controllers are read? We're changing inputs at a rate of 8,000 times a second. Not quite feasible for a human, but not a problem for an emulator. What does this achieve? Like, why would we do this? Well, this moves the PC to RAM. But why? Let's talk about the IRQ, or interrupt request. It's a way for the programmers to schedule a function to run during a precise moment of the screen rendering process. Regardless of what code is currently being executed, if the IRQ occurs, the PC is moved to the IRQ routine. Eventually, an RTI instruction will be executed, returning the PC to where it was before the IRQ. Mario 3 uses it primarily to keep the HUD in place while the rest of the screen scrolls. The level geometry is rendered with specific scroll offsets, but after the 190-second scan line, rendering is disabled, the VRAM address is modified, the scroll is reset, graphical banks are swapped out, and then rendering is re-enabled. Different situations in the game have different uses for the IRQ, but the premise is the same. Wait for a specific scan line, then run the timing-specific code. For the title screen, this is done to keep the checkerboard floor in one place while the curtains can rise. And the cause for the PC moving to RAM all has to do with this IRQ's jump to the code for the checkerboard floor. The logic for the non-maskable interrupt routine will swap out the program banks to update the graphics, schedule the IRQ, read the controllers, and then swap the banks back. At least that's how it's supposed to go. However, this is the logic that we exploit. Banks are swapped out, the IRQ is scheduled, we maliciously press different buttons at a rate of 8 kHz 100 different times, and then before the banks are swapped back, the IRQ is fired. The IRQ routine's logic checks the value of address 101 and determines we're on the title screen. The PC is moved to address A826, which should be the code that adjusts the screen to show the checkerboard floor, but the wrong program banks are loaded. Since the IRQ routine pushes data to the stack, when we execute this RTS instruction, the data that was pushed is used as a return address. Obviously, this was never meant to happen. This pulls off 0 and 0, which will move the PC to address 0, and then the instruction ends incrementing the PC to address 1. That's right, we're executing RAM! Remember the wrong warp TAS? We use the enemy expositions to write a jump to the credits, since the enemy expositions are easy to manipulate and those bytes get executed. Now we're in a similar situation. The contents of RAM will be processed just like before, only now instead of enemy expositions, we need to find something else to write code with. From here, we need to know what bytes we're able to manipulate. Address 17 and 18 are controlled by controller 1, as well as address F5 and F7. Address F6 and F8 are controlled by controller 2. These bytes are the total held and newly pressed buttons for each controller. For instance, if I'm holding down the start button last frame and continue holding it, and on this frame I pressed the right button, the total held is start plus right, but the newly pressed is only right. In a similar way to how you can write assembly code by manipulating an enemy's position, I could write 2 bytes of assembly code by pressing a specific combination of buttons on the controller over 2 frames. If we use the bytes at address F5, which includes both controller 1 and 2, we have a total of 4 bytes to manipulate. This could allow for some actually useful code to be written. However, Mario 3's controller reading routine will mask away D-pad conflicts. That means I'm not able to simultaneously press left and right. The same applies for up and down. Unfortunately, this limits the code that we can write with this technique. If you were thinking about writing a jump to address 8FE3, sorry, but you're out of luck. And yet, not all hope is lost. There are 2 more bytes we have control over, and that's address 0 and 2. When we perform the DPCM audiobook workaround exploit by pressing buttons really, really, really fast, the final buttons that we press for controller 1 and 2 will be stored in address 0 and 2. I recognize that this part of the video can be overwhelming. I initially planned to talk about every minute detail. Most of these details aren't even relevant to this task though, so I'm leaving it as a footnote. Pause the video if you want to learn more about the bytes and RAM. Otherwise, let's talk about the goals. 1. We need the stack pointer to be greater than hex 30. It is currently 8. If this condition isn't met, the stack being used for normal stack purposes will overwrite address 100, which is important because 2. Address 100 needs to be hex 20. In a similar way to how address 101 is used for the IRQ routine, address 100 is used for the NMI routine. If it's not 20 during the credits, the game will softlock. And finally, 3. We need to jump to address B85A. Before I walk through my TAS, let's walk through the TAS from SGDQ 2016. We're only going to be setting up requirement 3, so the game will softlock during the credits. But that's okay. After all, we're just using this TAS as an example so you can have a better understanding of the more complicated one. Also, for simplicity, we're only going to be working with addresses F5 through F8. Let's open up BizHawk, load Mario 3, and then change the core to SubNeshawk. This will allow for subframe inputs on the timeline. We'll open up TAS Studio. This is where we're going to input the inputs. Let's begin with a series of alternating inputs. This is the DPCM audiobook workaround exploit. The DPCM audiobook workaround exploit is used to move the PC to address 1. The program counter reaches about address 7 before the frame ends and the NMI occurs. During the NMI routine, controllers are read. For controller 2, I'll press A plus start plus up. I won't press anything with controller 1. The NES will continue processing until V blank, and the NMI occurs while the program counter is around address E5. During the NMI routine, controllers are read. I will continue to hold A plus start plus up on controller 2, while now also pressing select. I'll press B plus start plus left plus up with controller 1. This will write 5A, 20, 5A, B8, at address F5 through F8. When executed as code, this will be no op, JSR B85A. This will run the Princess Rescue cutscene, though once the curtains drop, the game has softlocked since requirements 1 and 2 were not met. You may recall the issues we had writing a jump to address 8F E3. We're unable to write 8F or E3 with controller inputs. However, by using the Japanese release of the game, the function to set up the credits is in a slightly different location. Address 8F F4. This is the key ingredient to making the run work. I will now explain how a run of this game can satisfy all three requirements in less than a quarter of a second. The console is booted up, and I wait until the controllers are read. I perform the DPCM audiobug workaround exploit, and the final inputs for controller 2 are A plus start. Then the final inputs for controller 1 is simply select. This will store 20 and 90 at address 0 and 2, a surprise tool that will help us later. Though right now we're executing address 01, so we'll need to circle back to those. The PC reaches address 7 before the NMI occurs. For this next set of button presses, I stall for a single controller read, if you need to know why, here's a footnote on screen, and then I press select on controller 2. For controller 1, I press A, plus select, plus left, plus up. This will store hex AA in address 17 and 18, which gets executed. Opcode AA is for the TAX instruction. Transfer A to X. When this executes, A is equal to FA, so now X is equal to FA. The NES will continue processing until V blank, and the NMI occurs while the program counter was around address DB. For this next set of button presses, I will continue to hold select for controller 2. For controller 1, I will let go of select, continue holding A plus left plus up, and now press start. Address F5 through F8 now reads 10, 0, 9A, 20. When executed, this is branch on plus 0 bytes. This branch is taken, but moves the PC 0 bytes. Then transfer X to stack pointer, satisfying requirement 1, then JSR 00. Address 00 reads 20, 00, 90. Since those are the buttons we pressed while running the first frame's DPCM audiobug workaround exploit. This is executed as JSR 9000. This is slightly offset code, but it reads FFA9A8, or ISC address A8A9. In case you're curious, ISC is an undocumented opcode, but this instruction did not affect anything, so don't worry about it. After that, executing from address 9003 works out just fine. The value of address 100 is set to 20, and the PC is jumped to address B85A, satisfying requirements 2 and 3. The credits play in full, and Super Mario Bros. 3 was completed in 0.2159 seconds. Well, that was exciting. In case you're curious, Super Mario Bros. 3 is not the only game that can be abused this way. Many other games have a similar DPCM audiobug workaround, and so they too can be infinitely looped with alternating inputs. Now, the case of Mario 3 is specifically due to the order of operations I talked about before, and it's also lucky that the IRQ routine jumps to an unloaded program bank. Different games have different orders of operations, and not all of them are vulnerable. That being said, I have created subframe TASs for Kirby's Adventure, The Legend of Zelda, and Gimmick, but those would definitely be a topic for a later video. In the many years it took me to get around to making this video, I did some more research and I found a way to beat Super Mario Bros. 3 about 43,000 times faster. No, really. I've spent the past several months working on this and I'm very excited to get that video out next.
This is your cue to subscribe to the channel so you don't miss it!
And that's about it. In the meantime, if you want to talk about this video or ask about the next one, feel free to join my Discord server. If you want to support me, I made a keyboard and mouse platforming game called Fantastic Fist, which is currently on sale. Check out the free demo while it's on sale and see if it's something you'd be interested in. I'll also be answering questions about this video in the comments if I failed to explain something. I will go into ridiculous detail answering questions if needed. By the way, thank you so much for watching, it means the world. I plan to start taking my YouTube videos a bit more seriously, whatever that entails. And with that, I think I'm done here. I'm off to beat Mario 3 even faster. I hope to see you then.